IVM.
कृपया ध्यान दीजिए, the language used on the podcast may not be fit for consumption. We warn you, tread carefully. But listen, yaar, don't be so conservative. All right, finally. We have a very important guest. It's all my fault. I'll come to that in a second. Aditi Mittal, one of the leading stand-up comedians of India, male or female.
Nice.
Top five, I'm told. Top five in earnings. Top three in renown. Way ahead of Kunal Vijayakar, who's at 46, that loser. And of course, I'm out of the rat race now because I'm a philosopher. And so I'm above bloody comedians.
You're above comedy now.
I'm above. I'm the guy on the terrace who urinates on all the people below and says, Kemcho. One sec. That's me. Huh? I'm just talking about me. Nobody else. Let's quickly get into my story for the day. Aditi, you can join me on this one. It's very interesting. They've now pointed out, scientists, you know how we do our research. Let me just say those people, scientists, somebody somewhere. Well, somebody somewhere, Mr. and Mrs. Sharma, came up with this lovely theory, and it's verified by other people on building WhatsApp, so it's true, that dogs can smell and trace COVID as well as your tests, your PCR, RTT, LLMB, LOKK tests that they're doing. So all you need to do is train your dog to smell if the person is COVID positive or not. So I'm doing it because I have a lot of dog haters in my lane. More than dog haters, they're disconnected animal people who just overreact. You see the dog, hey! And my Mary is a little extra friendly and goes and smells them. So here I've devised it. I've been training them. If you're COVID positive, my dog Peter, let's take a look at him. He's here somewhere. I don't know if you can see him. Peter, say hi.
Hello, Peter. Hi.
Fast asleep. Peter will hump your leg. Okay, and that's a sign immediately that you're COVID positive. You can have the 5 minutes of pleasure, and then we'll, you know, call the doctors and get you properly tested. And Mary is going to basically urinate on your toes because she's a little shorter, so she can't reach anywhere. So this is a great thing for me. I'm so happy that the dogs have saved the day, and we don't waste money on tests. You can do a test later to verify if you want it. That's up to you. But dogs, this is proper information. You know I'm never wrong. This is science at its best. Aditi Mittal, you have a dog.
Yes.
Go ahead and make sure you're safe across the neighborhood and locality you live in. Every
community,
have your dog check them for COVIDity.
That's beautiful. And you know, in fact, I actually, from what I read, they also called me and said that actually the cure is the humping. They can sniff it on you, and if they hump you, you're fine.
So you don't need to take the vaccine. So it's almost like the third dose.
It's our national vaccination strategy, in fact.
Then is it important whether the person who's being humped is male or female? Because my dog is male. There's no gender bias issue. I don't want trouble later.
No. You know, I mean, and the thing is, gender's a spectrum. So is COVID.
Right.
Sometimes you get leg humping COVID. Sometimes you get foot peeing COVID.
Right.
Sometimes you get like balls licking COVID.
There you go.
Not yours, obviously, their own.
Whatever. Let's not get into that. We're just trying to put it out there. Fair enough. It's a platform for science. Yeah.
Correct. I mean, we're scientists.
And we're backed up, supplemented by cow urine, which is a proven fact. So between cow urine and Peter humping your leg, that's it. Nature has saved us. Or as my bio teacher used to say, Netur has come to help your futur. So we're all good. We're all good, Aditi. But let's talk about you. Otherwise, I'll rant about rubbish and you'll join me. And although the show is all about that only.
Hena, I was just going to say, I came expecting rubbish.
Oh, I thought you had good news. Mittal was able to ovulate at the right time. And Ashish Shakya is now a proud father of 7 children.
Hi, I'm Zarina Poonawalla, host of the Empowering Series podcast on the IVM Network. I happen to be a peak performance coach and leadership coach by profession, and I'm here to share with you productivity tools, life-altering techniques, and real-life hacks to help you achieve your maximum potential in everything you do, your relationships, professions, careers. So tune in every Monday to unleash your inner power. Be safe, be well, be empowered.
Okay, Aditi, you know, let's start at the beginning. Again, you've achieved too much. I hate that. So we can't cover everything. We'll have to cover what you want to cover. But I want to go back right to the beginning, because those are the most interesting stories, is before you become anything.
Oh,
right? The transition,
yes.
In a sense.
Yes.
So tell us about young Aditi Mittal when she was a little girl, and what is the background? Where did comedy actually begin? Then we'll go through all these things all the way up to your 3 specials, if we can. So,
you know, I was born on a dark and stormy night. It was a sort of like, I mean, I'm into dogs, candlelight dinners, and I'm an alcoholic.
No, this is not shadi.com. I want to go back to your bachpan. Ki baat hai, bhai.
I forgot. Yeah, yeah. So, I was actually born on Diwali. Cyrus, I was born on Diwali.
My
mother was playing cards. Yeah, thanks. My mother was playing cards and she went into labor. And then she'd never forgiven me for the 300 bucks she lost that day. Because 300 bucks was a lot of money at that time. It's still. And then here I am. I literally, nothing else happened in the middle. I was born and then I got a call saying, hey, you want to be a
where did you Where did you grow up, Aditi? I'll have to be more specific because now I'm dealing with a five-year-old. You made it clear. Where exactly, I'm trying to remember because when I first met you, when you came to our show and all that, you did tell us. And I'm a week I did was in Bombay. You grew up somewhere else.
I grew up in Pune and Panchkani. I went to boarding school.
Wow.
And I grew up
Panchkani.
In
Panchkani. School. Huh.
Boy, it was amazing. So I went to St. Mary's and St. Joseph's and came out as St. Jesus.
Hey, stop. What? Silvery, our producer is also a Panchkani kid for some years. Yeah, so when he comes on, I don't know, he can come in for a quick second and just tell us which school he was in. Maybe it's the brother sister school, I'm not sure.
You know, possibly.
I was in Sanjeevan Vidyalay.
What?
Sanjeevan Vidyalay.
Sanjeevan Vidyalay. Does it ring a bell?
Yes, it does. Okay, so because the fact is that Panchkani has 135 boarding schools.
Oh, wow.
135 ass boarding schools. So it was just, I mean, that whole place, that whole hill station is a vibe. It's just hormones of like just desperate teenagers trying to talk to someone of the opposite gender. And that energy sort of coagulates over the hill station in a ball and rises over the earth. And that's how Haryana was born.
So it's a breeding ground of not just education is what you're trying to tell me, is it?
No, not at all. So, no, in fact, hardly any education.
So the stereotype obviously would be that Aditi tries to hold her own and realizes she's a little funny. Would that be the... Because everybody has a different story and sometimes the stereotype is...
Yeah, so you know, I was in a girls' boarding school. I was in a girls' college. And I think that was one of the reasons I was the class clown. I was that like person, I was overly attention-seeky, which translated into this.
So can you introspect here for a second? I hate to act like an idiot, but that's my thing. But people ask me the same thing. Were you like, you know, do you want attention? What is the reason? Do you want attention? Do you want an identity? You suddenly know you're good at that and that gives you a status. As in, they make you that class clown because Aditi is known to be funny. So sometimes they're almost pushed into their window. It's like how I was told I was bad at maths. All the boys would laugh at me and say, I'm bad at maths, and I became bad at maths. Auto suggestion. So what do you
because
think happened?
They said, yeah. Dude, I think
it's true.
Because, you know,
these things happen.
Yeah, no, and so I'll tell you the truth, okay? This is a little bit ego, but like, I always wanted my dad's attention, okay? I always wanted my dad's attention because he was, I lost my mother when I was really young.
Ooh.
And I was in boarding school, so I didn't really get a lot of parental attention when I was younger. And so whenever I would come back home, I realized that like when his friends and all are sitting around, they would be like, chalo bachche log andar jao, right? I used to be the only kid allowed to sit with the adults because I used to say dumb shit. Because I used to say stupid stuff and they would be like, "Arey, this Aditi's an idiot." And I would just be like, yeah.
These are five middle-aged men with drinks in their hands.
Yes.
And what would you as a young 10, 12-year-old, how would you contribute to the conversation?
I would dance to this Chaya Chaya, which was my permanent this thing. I would dance to the other one also. Yes. And to the point that like my dad's friends stopped visiting because they were like rendu. But you know, it was one of those needs. Like it was always that need to sort of be welcomed anywhere. And that's kind of where it
came. Or you were just exuberant and exhibitionistic and trying to, you know, get their attention. That I get. But were you also funny?
A combination, I think. A combination.
So would someone say, beta, idhar aa, jokes now and all that. Would it go into that realm?
I was like jazz hands all the time. I think of myself as a triple threat. I'm an asshole, I'm a bitch, and I'm a cunt. But I'm also an actor, writer, and singer. Right? And so...
Self-deprecation is the best thing. I used to use it all my life. So when people start abusing you, it just water off your back.
It doesn't hurt.
Yeah.
It doesn't hurt.
I remember telling her one.
I'm like, what can you say about me when I've already said it about myself?
Exactly. I had a girlfriend with this guy. In my day, we had landline. So people used to call up and just, you used to just call her like, you know, Randy, whore, and all these difficult words. She used to keep crying. She was like aghast and frustrated Indian male. So then I told her that my strategy was, I told her instead of anything, because I picked the phone and abused him back and it went nowhere. So I said, next time, just keep agreeing with him. Or just go on agreeing with him. Let's see how much he can take. You know, Aditi, she wore him down. It was like Pujara batting. She just wore him down. He went on, you're a slut, yeah, I'm a slut. You're a chut, yeah, I'm a chut. And after 10 minutes, he had nowhere to go. It was game, set, and match. And we didn't realize, but it was almost like non-violence, you know, the Gandhian theory, or Mandela for that matter. It just works. It actually works. People don't understand you, but you have to keep calm. You're taking sledge.
You know, here's my thing to that, is that, but then doesn't that also become auto-suggestive? Doesn't that also become, then like at some point you start internalizing what you say about yourself.
You're too intelligent for us. See, for us, it works on the one. We are one level, one dimensional people. When once you go to layers, you're screwed. Yeah.
Okay. But you know, I believe this is also, I don't know, maybe it's a comedian thing, and I want to know if you do this. Is I always imagine the worst case scenario. If I want something, I will imagine me not getting it and then me getting fucking drowned in a tub of dirt and then dying. I will imagine the worst case scenario in anything just to kind of make myself unattached from things.
Some sort of reverse sociopathic self-esteem issues for sure. But having said that, I don't think it's the worst way to go. I'm sure there's a psychology base to it where you basically imagine the worst so you don't ever fear failure in a sense, right?
Yeah. Yes. That's it actually. To get rid of the fear of failure, I'm like, just imagine failing spectacularly. What's the worst that could happen now?
Yeah. Also, I think only people who take themselves very seriously will fall into that trap. I think most of us are struggling, no matter how many years we're in the business. If you're not struggling in money, you're struggling with health. You're struggling with health. You're struggling with, you know, a relationship. So there's no end to struggle. Mein Kampf, no pun intended, continues. Okay. Now, please take that in the right spirit. I'm no fan of that idiot. I don't like men with small mustaches. If I go to a restaurant and a small mustache serves, it's like racism for me. I'm like, grow your mustache or don't put the drink down here. Aditi, let's talk about your life, which is very interesting. So you've given us a little brief thing, but just one last word on it. So you didn't ever, there's no focus in your head to go into comedy. What was in your head as a 15, 16, as you get that 10th, 11th, you know, where you started thinking about what to do?
I wanted to be a journalist or a veterinary doctor.
But you know, it's not so far away. Veterinary doctor is, but you're not so far away as a journalist. I'm just thinking, because what a real journalist would want to basically sort of change the world or flash their light on certain things, you know, comedians doing the same thing. So yeah, so it's not that different, right? In a way, you're just a funny version of that. You're doing the same thing. Your long stand-ups, the sets and all are not, you know, there'll be points and some poignant moments in each one of them. At least, there will be an intent sometimes and there'll be a subconscious intent sometimes. So we'll come to that. So just take us through the process now. So what happens at your journalist vet? What happened to your dreams?
Destroyed, mostly. I feel like, you know, honestly, I started doing this. And so I went to the US, okay? I studied and I went with big aims, ambitions to do...
This is after SAT or GMAT?
After SAT. That because means... I was like, Papa, yahan pe koi aur mere jurabez hota hai. मुझे जाके यूएस में किसी और की जुराबे धोनी है तो फिर मैं वहां पे आई वेंट टू द यूएस एंड
सो अदिति कम्स फ्रॉम सर्टेन अमाउंट ऑफ मनी हां किड्स हु गो आफ्टर सैट आर द रिच किड्स बिकॉज़ गेटिंग अ स्कॉलरशिप नॉट दैट इजी एनीवे ठीक है रिच अदिति वेंट ऑफ
टू आई गॉट अ स्कॉलरशिप
ओके वेयर डिड यू गो
आई वेंट टू अ यूनिवर्सिटी दैट आई लाइक टू कॉल आई मीन एक्चुअली द नेम इज फेयरली डिकिंसन यूनिवर्सिटी But it was very self-aware university.
If you didn't give that little laugh in the beginning, your Shekhar Suman moment, I wouldn't have laughed. It would have just gone over my head. But because you laughed at the name, I got your subtext. So don't do that. Don't project. You're killing me. I'm a moron. I pick up all
you're
the subtext.
You're saying auto-suggestion.
Auto-suggestion, subtext, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah. But it was a very self-aware university because in the university ka bookshop, we had a sweatshirt that said, suck my Dickinson University.
Wow.
You know? So it was great fun. I did 4 years over there. I thought I wanted to do. I got in politics and political science and economics ki degree karne ke liye. I was like, I'm gonna nail it. Then I switched to theatre in the first semester. Lost my.
Wait, so you could do them side by side.
You know, because they have liberal arts, no? So then you can do everything and your first year, so you have to do like every course ka. You have to do one.
Especially if you're in India. Paisa vasool karna padega. You've gone there, you study from aeronautical engineering to how to groom the cat. Everything is done. Yeah, super.
Correct. And so I did that. And then first semester, I went to an introduction to acting class, and this guy made us act. He said, you are a slice of bacon. And now imagine that the bacon, the pan is getting hotter.
The idea is not allowed in 36 countries of the world. But anyway.
Hotter. Dude, I'm telling you, I saw a bunch of adults doing like acting like bacon on the floor. And I was like, I want to do this for the rest of my life. And so I changed my major, lost my scholarship. And then told my parents in the third year that I had changed my major. And then after I graduated, obviously, with my skill level and my...
One second, get back to the acting thing. So you kept that?
In fact, I did a lot of...
You moved from bacon to sausage, from sausage to steak.
All
banned products in India now. But it's good. So it was like losing inhibition, sort of training in the beginning, etc.
Yeah.
Which coming from, a upper middle class Indian background, where you're always correct and you have to be careful. It's a little alien to how we would project ourselves if we stayed with the parents and the subculture.
Oh, yeah. Oh, definitely. Oh, that's such a good observation.
Those five uncles go mad if you say, "Dek, Papa, dek, main bacon ban gayi hu."
Hai wo bhai, chacha. Under me or bacon me? Yeah, correct. And so that really sort of like, it opened up my mind and led me. I think, you know what, also, I always wanted to sing and dance, but the business of singing and dancing is what I understood when I did that degree. And then I graduated and got no jobs. Okay, I was working for a couple of theaters as their fundraising intern or whatever. And then recession hit. I lost my job.
Which year is this? 2009.
2009.
Oh, right then. 7 to 9 was the recession, wasn't it? Yeah.
So, ouch. 2009, my boss takes me, and that time I was working for a company which was doing like, which basically, it was like Baba Ramdev ka yoga videos. You get there and then they would make white ladies do the exact same thing.
Mistake number one on the podcast. Mistake number two is the name. Carry on. Yeah.
No, sorry. Baby Ramdev.
The views famous of the guests are their own. I like the products though.
Sorry.
How do we know? The one I use for piles is fabulous. My worry is that the same one is used in all other products also.
It's also the toothpaste. The piles one is the toothpaste one.
It's a way to bond. Back to your story. Sorry.
So then I lost my job, and I was working for this company where they would take yoga videos from babas in India and then make white ladies do the same thing. Okay, and I'm telling you, that business was going.
That's the secret of yoga success in the West, anyway, isn't it?
Correct. You matlab, the moment like Karen from Minnesota is doing Kundalini, you're like, I would like to be involved. And so I was working for that, and then they fired me. I mean, they were like, let me go.
You're the only one who doesn't know or care about yoga and their whole group.
Yes.
Despite your ethnicity, that's beautiful. That's the best story you've told me.
That was exactly it. I did not know diddly squat. Dude, they used to go for hot yoga classes and all in their lunch breaks. And I would eat their dabbas. So it was actually a pretty fruitful sort of employment. Then my boss took me for a walk around the block, said, look, we're shutting down the company. Sorry. So then for a year, I was on my CPT, which is curriculum of practical training, which is a visa. And I did manicures and pedicures for diabetic people. And I babysat for a year. Okay, with the hope.
Why diabetic people? What's the thing?
So diabetes actually affects your nerve endings, but on your feet. So it gets incredibly sensitive. Like even touching your feet can like cause like jarring sensation in your legs. And so you need to have a specially soft hand. Do you have diabetes?
No, I've got a fractured knuckle here, right? Left knuckle. And my left bicep is swollen and torn, and my left shoulder pec joint area is hurt. So I couldn't bench. So I had to switch back to back workout.
Wait, what happened? How? All that broke.
While incline pressing, I brought it too close to my face. I could feel the pain. I was just trying to find a more.
Are you still working out?
Huh?
Are you still working out?
What else do I do?
Through the lockdown?
There's a lockdown, I say I'm against the government, both center and state, and I walk around and look for work and fight with the police. I'm a Kranti Veer. One man, the revolutionary, on my own. I can't find a cult following. I tried my best. They all stay at home. Nobody wants to get out. Back to your story, please. So diabetes, I didn't know this. So they have real pain and trouble with that area.
Okay. Correct. And so then, and because my dad was diabetic, I used to give him manicures and pedicures. So I knew how to listen. So I used to give manicures and pedicures. So I used to go into people's houses and give $25 ke liye one pedicure, which was cheaper than even going to like a...
This is a good job. $25 for a pedicure is not bad if you have a market.
Yeah, I did.
So you do four days, $100 into $3,000 a month. There you go.
Yeah, I mean, actually, the thing is, even babysitting pays so well there.
How much?
Like, I was getting paid, I think, $11.75. And that too, I didn't have to do anything. I just wanted to go and watch TV in their house.
Correct.
Their child already asleep.
If the baby falls, you just run away.
Just
they don't have any
details.
Yeah,
like I was watching TV.
Could you charge more for ugly babies? I mean, would that be fair?
Yeah.
It would
be fair.
I think so, yeah. You know. You come in, the Smiths say, this is, you know, Julie. You go like, $15. That's a fair assumption. Why do we act it out? How juvenile is that?
it's also the impulse to keep talking. It's one of our classic traits is that you just can't let her, because you're like worried that if you stop, there will be silence. And if there's silence, oh my God, I hate silence.
I don't even think about that much. I just go on talking because I'm not listening. I realize that, you know, I'm the worst person to do a podcast. Unless I do it myself, you know, which is what we're planning on doing later. So you did all these odd jobs. Where's the comedy?
So the thing is, I was also simultaneously acting and doing classes at Upright Citizens Brigade, which is a theater in New York City, which was recently called out for its unfair labor practices. But hey, but I came back to Bombay and I saw stand-up comedy happening, right? And I saw, and I was like, yeah, I can do this. And the thing is, in college, I had done stand-up once. Because I was in a sorority, which I had joined for the scholarship. And so it was, I'm not going to say this because it's a mean thing to say. But I was in the sorority for the scholarship and they said this thing called Greek Week. And so I did stand up there and I won for 2 years in a row. And it was pretty like, I was like, I'm funny. I knew that.
So, so you would do like ethnic Indian, so what would you hit at that point? Because you're surrounded by 80%... 90% Americans and maybe 10% foreigners. What would you talk about?
So, you know, I think at that point, like, you know, now in fact, we double down on our identities. We're like, I'm an Indian, I'm a human, I'm a woman, whatever, right? At that time, I was very eager to blend in. And I still think, you know, like a part of it is, it's our sort of upper caste, upper class mentality where you're like, nene gore log hoge to acha hai vega. Like, so I used to do jokes. I remember doing a joke about, a particular... religious figure who used to have 12 friends. And I was like, how can this religion be against...
Your mother will shoot you, be careful. Go on, finish the joke.
I said, how can this religion be against, same-sex marriage?
They're not 12 friends. They're 12 believers. At that point, not even great believers, but followers. After he returns, they then become real great disciples and propagate the religion.
Huh.
And so all die in different ways.
I mean, don't we all eventually...
No. Before natural death took them. But why am I trying to show
really?
Off?
Is that true?
I have so much more time than you on my hands. I need the Bible. Finish the joke.
So, my joke was that how
in
can...
In return, by the time you finish.
Thank you. My joke was, how can a person who hangs out with 12 dudes be against same-sex marriage? And that sort of like was my big, like everyone was like, yeah, man, that's
funny. I think that's more Old Testament than New Testament. I don't know if JC was against it personally. Huh?
Yeah, oh, for
it's
sure.
But the libertarian. Oh, for sure. So let's all start a religious war. Both of us have half-baked knowledge here. But listen, Aditi, so that was it. Then you come back to India. We have to fast forward because we're going to a break soon. And I need to mention the special. So you saw an amateur night and you went up.
Yes, I saw an amateur night. I went up and I was like, yaar, mere kaun se mame chache yahan pe baithe that I have to get nervous and all. I did it and
there
I
no
got
females,
2 lakh.
Huh? There were no females, if I remember correctly, around 2010-11.
No, Padmini was there. Padmini Harchand Rai, if you remember correctly.
Yeah, Paddy. Thank you. Okay.
So Padmini was there and Padmini was a friend of a college friend as well. So I saw, the moment I did it at, Cafe Goa. Cafe Goa in Bandra,
yeah.
And she had done it at Blue Frog, and then I and because we had a common friend, I called her and I was like, what is this stuff? And you know, I want to sign up for it, and I signed up for it. I did not even, I had 2 minutes, I didn't even finish my set, and I got like some 4 laughs. So I was like, I want to do this for the rest of my life.
That's a lot, bro. That's not bad at all. First, don't call her bro. And secondly, you know, that I think that's great, not finishing the set. I'm guilty of that myself all the time because this trying to set up something takes me half an hour. By the time I get to the point. So then how did that... No, I remember you came to our show. So at that time, you were still trying to make your name and all that. I don't think you were as well known at all. And you came and you had a horrible experience. You want to tell us about that with Kunal Vijaykar? who instead of encouraging you, because I think you something with the accent, he wanted this way or that way. I can't remember the details too much, but I do remember, as usual, his leadership was poor. And it upset you and you cried and all that. That's why I'm trying to...
Quite a bit.
And so did the rest of the crew. It was only him because there's no idea how to manage people.
No, it's okay. It's, you know what, honestly, I learned from... It was, first of all, so much fun. Because that was the first time I had gone into makeup and hair. And it was incredible. I had such a great time doing those sketches. You know, I was very scared.
That's all fine. That's fair. Everybody's scared at some point.
But I was just shit scared the entire time.
This is not a criticism of Kunal. I want to just point out here, it was his birthday yesterday. Kunal, if you're listening, first rule of leadership. Somebody comes there excited, enthusiastic, full of beans, and of course, anxiety ridden and fear ridden as well. And when she asks, can she do it again? If you say, no, it's okay. In that tone, you've destroyed her confidence and made us all look like evil men. It goes into many different layers of gender bashing and young people bashing and everything else. It was horrible leadership and you should be penalized for at least the next 10 years. But you have been. You're suffering every day. Okay. All right. Yeah. But that was terrible. But you were a talented girl and you were doing your thing and you were trying to be inventive. And I wish I had interfered more.
No,
but I think as usual, I had my own problem with a rash in my groin area and... so I wasn't really paying attention.
I would have been very hurt if you had ignored that. We would be sitting here if you had ignored that.
Everybody has their own cross to bear. Oops, here we go again. Okay, I apologize. No, listen. Yeah, I have Christian antecedents also. Please don't come after me. Aditi, let's get into... So you were doing all these little things. That's a story for many people who get the equity in the market by actually doing... I think that's important, is it not? You get four laughs, or you work in a crowd that doesn't like you, or you have to deal with a certain type, so whose political philosophy will be one way and you're prepared the other way, and then you'll switch on the spot. So these things, take us through all that, because it's a learning ground which no one can really give you.
Yeah, and you know what, I realized that actually this career or this profession is a study in failure and hope. Those are the only two things. Success also comes, when success comes, it's very visible. But there's a lot of unseen, most of your things that you're doing, the struggle underneath is completely unseen. I think that's what it is about. And your failures and your success is what is visible. And I mean, I want to people who will look at stuff that I look at stuff that I wrote 5 years ago and I'm like, what is wrong with me? But that was sort of the growing process. And now people will still judge you on that. People now still call me bra panty girl because those are some of the few videos of mine that have gone hugely viral. But they don't know that I've been living a life apart from bra panty boob dicks. And it's just, I mean, it's a little bit tragic, but it is also what it is. I realize my aim is not to be famous or be like well-known or really successful or whatever. My job is, my dream is to work really long. My dream is to keep, till I'm 90. I want to be you. But 20 years later, also you.
Watch the pec tear and all that, huh? As you age, be careful of lifting weights. You're not that young. But let's just get back to the fact that you do everything. I think that's also nice that the canvas is always open. You're one of those people, you're very liberal in your mind. Laugh Out Loud, for example, which is, you can't even place it. It's a silly reality show sort of thing. It's, but you're happy to try. So you'll do anything, anything. Oh, that sounds horrible. You know what I mean?
You know what? I mean, you might not be that far off.
Yeah, yeah.
What was LOL like for you, Cyrus?
It was fun. I thought, by the way, please tell them how you all cheated and all of you all attacked me for 2 hours and abused me and my penis and my wife and my relationship, my sexual proficiency and all that, which they didn't show. They just showed the end when I completely broke. But imagine me sledged by 5 Australian fielders for 6 hours without stopping. And you were the main culprit, you and Suresh.
You know, so and we Malika. When we were backstage, okay, and this is a hot goss, okay. So then... Bummel is like this Cyrus. This Cyrus is not breaking. I'm telling you, even while you were doing your showtime, no, we are all every eye was on the screen. He's ye hustle na, ye bas hustle. Like several times, Arshad is like, he smiled. Let's do it. And production will be like, no, he didn't smile. And so we had planned it. I was told that I was like, you know what, Aditi, when you go in, because they said, okay, Aditi, next zombie round, go put on your Luchika costume and they. And I was like, I'm going to... actually, no, Baman said. He's like, please, Cyrus.
Yeah, you know what was the difficult...
Like,
The difficult part for me was Malika and you had this conversation about my sexuality and things in a very normal way. Okay, just across my face, like as you were saying, "Haan, maine suna ki bahut chota hai." "Haan, bahut chota hai." "Maine suna bhi nahi bataya." And I was like, it was so funny and offensive, of course, but and so they would not play it. But I wish they played because I want to know who wouldn't break. You know, you cannot not react. And I didn't. But the moment they stopped that music, because I was holding it in so much, a smile came. You know what I mean? Oh,
that really happened, yeah.
Yeah, oops. Oops. It's like premature, late mature ejaculation. I guess that's what happens as you get older. Let's get back to your story. Yeah, so you did LOL, for example, which is, you know, a fun thing. And you were great fun. And I think we had a good team. Everybody, it was good vibes and good fun.
Nah?
Yeah. But basically, you're a stand-up comedian. And then you went and got this big Netflix special. Is that the first big one?
Yes, that was the first. And you know what? Everyone wants to, like, shit on me, which is also great. I mean, so as long as you're thinking about me. But I got it way before I started whinging about the fact that there were no women on other lineups. I had been whinging. And you know what, honestly, I didn't even know that there was a, like, it was never something that struck me, oh my God, there aren't enough women and stuff like that, because I wanted to be one of the men. I didn't want to be, like, special. I was like, no, I want y'all to take me in the same vein as these people. And only afterwards, when some, like, one video went viral or whatever, and people are like, how dare you complain? I was like, yeah, Rabbi, now. And then, of course, all the coverage related to that Netflix special was like, oh my God, like, in your face. I was like, yaar, theek hai, top level talent to hai nahi vagina ki wajah se. In log ne Netflix special de diya, to ab yehi dunia sochega, to soch rahe now what to do. Then I got another one.
Is it like the female following is for the female? Does it work like that? That you have a whole 50% audience and market which is untapped because they don't have enough role models? Largely males. Males and Kunal.
If I'm a role model, one, please change your role models immediately. And second, dude, you know, I realize that it's also just a different perspective. Like, it's a variety of thought.
Yeah.
Which is just, in, like, which is more interesting. I mean, okay, so my, honestly, my fan base, my aim fan base is people's parents. I love it when, like, old people come up to me and they're like, we love your comedy. I'm like, yes.
Mine is divorced grandparents. For me, I feel they are neglected. Yeah, it's a small market, but you know, what aim where you can aim.
Yeah.
No, I'm asking you only because I think people don't think about it sometimes that if women, especially younger girls, identify with females, that's a whole market which would not necessarily turn to Abish Matthews with that much glee as they would to Aditi Mittal. I'm just thinking, if you're a 12-year-old girl, but why didn't I go towards female comedians or female, you know, sports personalities, etc., etc.? There is a gender bias from both sides.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. I mean, oh, yeah. I mean, that's good because in general, we'll take women, ironically, less seriously. Even as artists, even as comedians, we don't sort of look at them in the same way that we would look at a man sort of saying things. And as I said, I wanted to be a journalist, so I tend to get very, like, I have lots of thoughts in my head that
I need
like,
a crusade. You without a crusade, you can't go on.
Exactly.
So
exactly.
Are you the head of the women's women for comedy?
I am the head of nothing. Okay, I would not like to be in any club that would have me.
You're doing a Groucho Marx.
Groucho Marx said, yeah, correct. So I just, you know what? To be honest, I also think that stand-up comedy per se is one of those, like, it's a very solitary profession. You fucking write. And then you edit and you perform. So galiya aati to tumhare naam pe aati, taliya aati to tumhare naam pe aati hai. And I like that. And I think it's like in my head also, I'm very like anti-establishment. And I feel like the art form lends itself to that, where it's very like, you know, it's a single person standing behind a microphone and saying things. And boom, that's when magic happens.
I'll put it the other way around. Does Aditi Mittal have any role models in America or India? India, I presume it's a new market, but who are female?
Yes. Oh my God, you know, so I've now, I mean, of course, I just made all my role models female. So there's Paromita Vora. She is a filmmaker, documentary filmmaker. And you've got to get her on this show, dude. She is incredible.
Does she charge?
You know, not nearly enough.
Damn you. If they don't charge, we don't get them. Ours is a classy show.
I want to make this worth the not money I'm getting. Paromita Vora is there. I love Shobha Day. I love Shobha Day. I just want to say, hers was the first. There was a book called Starry Night.
Of course.
Which I read. And it
was in Xavier's in our reading section. Yeah.
What?
It was. Shobha, I know it was raunchy and all that, but it was. There was a big argument about it and all. You can imagine. But she is seen as a feminist on one side, and then there's the literature right wing against the well, that's really odd to have a left wing, which because they're all left actually, but you know what I mean. So, yeah, but she's so a very ballsy lady. Also. I like her a lot.
Exactly. Yeah. Dude, you know what? And also, she was saying this stuff about being like progressive and equality and all this stuff at a time when nobody else was talking about
correct.
It. At a time when everyone else was like, care to them.
And she takes on everybody, you know, political establishment and all. She doesn't back off.
Yeah. Gotta enjoy. I love Shobha Day. She's also one of the people I love. Okay. And then in the actors and actresses, right now, I'm quite a fan of Richard Chadda and Chapasi Pannu and
okay, Kura all Mark. the government approved choices. Excellent. Let's take a quick break, which is actually no break, and we'll come back and continue. We'll squeeze in a couple of more questions. I want to talk about the next specials as well, and then we'll get Silvery to do AMAs with us. Cred is the best club I've ever been a part of. A highly exclusive club of trustworthy individuals who get rewarded for just paying their credit card bills on time. That's the club. You pay on time, you're part of the club. So where has Cred been all my life? Can you say it with more passion?
Like with that, you know, that VIP Frenchie wala passion.
Like, I like it.
What she
like
got that I ain't got. Where has it been? Okay, sorry.
Go.
Where has it been all my life?
Wow, Cred, where have you been? Should have come sooner. I wouldn't have had to marry my wife if I'd known about Cred before that. It's too late for me now, Aditi. Too late for me now. I'm married 20 years. And I love Cred, but I sort of like my wife also, whose birthday is on June 3rd. Send presents. No shaving kit this year. She doesn't like those kind of jokes. All right. Aditi, stop laughing, Silvery. If she sees this, she goes after all of us. Firstly, she thinks anyone listening to my podcast is a moron. So that, that alone is the problem. That she has no respect for me or the people, if there are any. God. Aditi, let's get back to you. Silvery is also a stand-up comedian. So then you moved from strength to strength. Suddenly you became really famous. I remember doing maybe it was in Pune. I'm not 100% sure. There was a show where we were both there. You had some four managers. I had nobody. three bodyguards took you in. People clamored around you. Lots of women, immediately could see that you had become that female role model. Women would look at me and, you know, immediately run away and say, oh God, not from that door or whatever. So you could see the difference immediately. But I saw that because I saw you in our show when you were a fledgling and the Kunal, you know, tried to destroy your career and your self-esteem. And then I saw you like this with, you know, 500 people screaming and with a very polished act, which is very funny. And those accents, the Maharashtrian Marathi bhai. I think that was also because it was Pune, was a very big part of that. And it was, you know, so there was a huge transition for someone like me to see many years later and all. And now you're moving from strength to strength. You've done 3 or 4 of these specials.
Yes, I've done 3 Netflix specials. I've done 2 Netflix and 1 Amazon Prime specials.
Because they're brothers.
Yes. And, the truth is, like, and thank you. So, Sairuk, you're being so nice right now. It's so jarring.
I'm a very positive guy. People keep thinking I'm a truth, which largely is true. But I'm actually very positive. I don't understand why knock people down for nothing, especially when they're in front of you. You got to wait.
After they leave, then you're like, chutiya thi.
No, my angst now is with society completely. I'm not going to waste my time attacking people trying to make their careers. They have no effect on me either. It's low-hanging fruit and unnecessary. When you have cops running around telling me to take my dog back in for no reason, you know, no oxygen and no beds and things. You know, keep my angst with the right
perspective.
People.
Perspective. Yeah. Perspective.
Don't try and attack a comedian because you didn't like one joke. And I mean, what's wrong with us? Really. Go on, sorry.
No, but you know that show, I remember, Poona Me, and dude, honestly, that makes me so uncomfortable. Like when people are like, oh, we'll pick and, you know, you need security and all that. It makes me so I hate that stuff, okay? But having said that, you know, that was like that. And I remember performing with you and I remember you, like I was coming off stage and you were like, that was really good. And Kunal was next to you.
Kunal was there?
Yeah, Kunal was there. And I walked off stage. You said that was really good. And then I walked further in and I think they took like a 15-minute break or whatever before your, you were closing the show. And in the break, I went to the dressing room and Kunal was there. And Kunal said that was really good. And I'm telling you,
always copies me. Yeah. It's no originality.
Dude, look. I was just like, oh. And I think I might have come off as like a complete fucking idiot. I was just shocked. I was just staring at him like this and I left. And
but people Silvery. Also
like...
Yeah, she's making light of it because that whole incident when she came to CNN for our show and all that, we all felt really bad later because she did nothing wrong, you know, and she was really eager. And he just killed her. You know how you kill someone's excitement? It's really a crime for me. You know, he could have done, all he had to do show interest in her, and criticizing it wasn't a problem. Do it this way, do it that way, should have done it. But he had this tone. You know, people have a tone, and it's like with dogs, what you say is not important, right? It's the tone. It's not like, yeah. like my dad would tell my German Shepherd when he's killing the Pomeranian, "Su karej dikra na kar, aista aista yahan dikra," and the dog is dead. So, you know, it's pointless. So, Kunal.
I like this. I've also been called a dog in this fucking podcast. Now,
I love dogs. But what Kunal was doing is he was saying one thing, but his face and tone was, you know, like you. I remember clearly you said, "Can I do it again?" Because you weren't happy also. You wanted to try something and there was enough time. And all he did was, "No, it's okay." And that's it. And she was just destroyed. It was worse than criticizing her. If he had shown interest, "Aditi, come on, you can do it this way. Aditi, come on, do it that way. Try the Delhi accent, German accent." That's all he had to do. And she was really eager. You know how eager she is. When many people, you know, ask her to stop talking and pay money and all, which is one of that tribe. So so from there, then to see her with people screaming her name and, you know, big clap, and you come on stage with established actors, get, you know, just the name, you get a roar. So you know you've reached the point because the audience has a certain expectation and they have a certain reverence to you. Well, it comes with age also, because they're like, "Oh, he's so old, we should clap." In our case, that wasn't the reason.
We need to clap so that they know they have to come on stage. Like, they didn't hear their own announcement because they're so old now.
Yeah, so I know we will make fun of it, but the fact of the matter is, I just saw that graph from her shattered, leaving the studio and all that, and then suddenly seeing her like a triumphant, you know, or queen of the hall thing. And I think poor Kunal wasn't performing, he must have been with me.
That motivated her more. That moment motivated her more.
No, but it could have broken her. It could. See, this is the problem. Parents should also understand sometimes, you know, because you say the wrong things to a child, you don't give them a chance to bloom. For me, I think those are the biggest crimes ever. You should never do that. Especially if she was established like she is now, I don't care. Because she can take it. But at that time, she was very vulnerable and she looked up to him. Didn't know that the man is, you know, there's 107 kilos of waste of my time.
You know what? Who was the most disappointed was my dad. Okay, because there was no bigger Kunal Vijaykar fan than my father, okay?
Oh, he's never met Kunal, apparently. Yeah.
So he was marketing director of Pantaloons or something.
Wow.
And
they used to do our plays. Rajiv Biyani used to give us clothes for plays. Yeah.
Correct. And so Kunal Vijaykar had come to one of their shoots or whatever.
Yeah.
And, you know, sort of, and my dad had met him during that time. And he loved Kunal. He used to watch his show all the time. And also, by the way, second thing, my dad loved your ass because we went to a show once. We came to watch, which is your stage show, which you were running
my marriage?
Maybe 12 years ago.
Oh, where have you gone? Where's she gone? I didn't touch anything.
Yeah, I think she just got disconnected somehow. I don't know how that happened.
Because anytime you praise me, the internet just shuts.
Yeah, this they're like, enough.
This is the reverse trolling that's been going on all my life. Stop it, stop it. the optic fiber just breaks.
Yeah, like I think anyone who praises you is actually Nullibug. So the internet goes immediately. Yeah.
But I'm so lucky that so few people praise me that when I do get praised, I don't know what to do. So I honestly don't believe they're telling the truth, and then I say all the wrong things, or, you know, make fun of them and they get upset and offended. So it's terrible. I much prefer hecklers. So used to that.
You know, Cyrus, I just realized that...
I banged my finger again.
Oh, damn, sorry. I just realized that your voice is 10 minutes behind.
It's the middle finger.
Your voice is 10 minutes behind, right? I think you're thinking that...
It was.
Yeah, I think you're thinking that the entire timing is off.
But where's someone has called you... Aditi? Let's start with the AMAs till she comes back in and she can finish her story.
Sure.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I'd like to thank the sponsors on the network this week, Cred, thewholetruthfoods.com, and Seat Tires. We really do appreciate the support. So the last year has been tough for all of us, and the second wave of COVID has really hit us badly. To help those affected by the pandemic in India, the podcasting community has come together under the Pod for Change banner to raise funds through an exclusive NGO partner, Give India. Join IVM and Pod for Change as we look to make a positive impact in the life of those affected by COVID-19. You can go to tinyurl.com/podforchangeindia and remember, somebody could really use the help. And now back to the promo. On the Simplified podcast, the gang explains the oxygen crisis happening in the country and tells us the various measures being taken to tackle it. On States of Anarchy, Amsani Hariharan talks about how the geopolitical relationships shaped COVID response and the world order. As Indians, we're all familiar with acid reflux or heartburn. Given the spicy food we consume, on The Habit Coach, Ashton has some simple solutions to counter that. Osama Moria explores the iconic neighborhood of Dadar and tells us his connection to outer space in Postcards from Nowhere. It was Dungle Time on The Fighting Goat as hosts Somesh and Arjun were joined by unbeaten MMA fighter and Commonwealth gold medalist Ritu Fogat. The traveling professor Siddharth Deshmukh shares examples of various innovations that came up during the COVID times and helped us deal with the situation. And with that, let us get you back to your show.
Follow me at Instagram and Twitter on Bored Brocha. I'm so bored, I need your help. I need your love. I need your touch. Okay, just follow me. People listening, Aditi is okay. Don't worry. Nothing happened to her. She wasn't in traffic. She's very much at home, but dropped the phone apparently. She'll soon sort it out. Hopefully, yeah.
Yeah, hopefully, yeah.
What's the comment?
Vikram Singh has called you Saiman Khan, which is a great... Saiman Khan is a great play on words. Vikram Singh, well done.
Maybe he's listened to the show where I've mentioned that some of the names, when the guy or the telemarketer or whatever, you're talking to someone who doesn't know you at all, they don't pick up my name. One of the names they pick up, they decide to take Suresh, Simon, Saibal. These are the names I get. So, aapka naam kya hai, sir? Yeah, so he may pick it up on that. I just give up.
Possibly. Yeah. It says,
Or maybe because I'm not wearing a shirt.
That's what I'm saying. You're not wearing a shirt. That's why.
Oh, yeah. It.
Gayatri Ravi asked...
You have asked Aditi before doing that.
Yeah, okay. I'll do it again when she comes.
I just shot LOL with her. So I have a certain level of comfort. It wasn't that long ago and then we did all these other things as well, press things. So when you're stuck together for 7-8 days, it's like being in a class, you know, literally.
Yeah.
So either you really get along or you don't. What do you think? My whole thing is a journey really kills a friendship or makes it. Like if you journey together, long drive in the car, long flight, and you know, at work, we've done this a lot. So you either get along with some guys and some people you really can't wait to get away from them, you know, as the journey gets longer.
Correct, something like that.
Okay, after that boring observation, we move on to the next AMA.
Gayatri Ravi asks, good morning.
Good morning.
Do you help your children with schoolwork, Cyrus? And please share some teaching ideas that will work out.
Yeah, but the thing is, my children have become a lawyer line of what, 4 generations of lawyers. They just argue. They never let you feel like the teacher, because the moment they give you the teacher thing, we human beings become, you know, very pedantic and teacher-like. No, Dad helped me with this history. So then your voice changes and you start teaching them in that teaching way. And then they start arguing and saying you're wrong and disrespecting you and then get out, I'll do it on my own. So it always ends badly, unfortunately. But I for 5 minutes, I do enjoy it. But I find a certain personality is more fun, enjoys teaching more. Like Kunal probably enjoys teaching more. Baman enjoys teaching more, being like, you know, a giver of information. I don't. I just like putting my legs up and scratching. Silvery.
Okay, I think I've just tried to text Aditi and I think she's offline. So maybe her internet crashed or something. Or lights went. You know, anything is possible.
See, no matter how successful you are in comedy, if you do not pay your Wi-Fi bills or if you're on Alibaba and have the same provider as me, you're never going to have any internet. And this is the problem. Right. In spite of coming from Lakshmi Mittal's family, one of the 5 largest, wealthiest people of the United Kingdom. And in spite of all that money, this cheapness and not, you know, spending and investing in your own Wi-Fi. It's very sad. Aditi, buck up. I don't want to hear these stories again. In the meantime, we'll have to finish.
I wanted to ask her about boarding school.
I know. I wanted to do. There's so much to talk about in the middle of her little conversation. And then we've had so many boring guests. They never get cut off. What's going on?
Exactly.
I mean, there are guests when you're thinking, can this optic go now? Next one.
Next one comes in from Sharath Tanuku. He says, good morning, Cyrus and company. My question is about the importance or the lack of or the lack thereof we give to financial literacy, that is about investments and savings at early stages of schooling. What do you think about this?
Oh, I agree. I'm so bad at that. And I think he's, I presume,
Sharath,
is spot on completely. Yeah, but you know, real life, this is the same thing with education, generally speaking. There's all, you can look at it in, from exercise, functional training where your body gets stronger, or aesthetic training where you're just looking better. Okay, so the same thing, the functional training in education is something they don't focus on enough, at least in India, I feel. Because you're stuck with refraction and reflection, which you'll never, you know, use in your life, or balancing calcium carbonate with, you know, H2SO4, whatever the hell it is. And it goes, it's good, but you know, it's pointless after a point unless you're a chemist or a physicist. But here, basic financial literacy and basic understanding of stock markets, bonds, shares, mutual funds, all the new financial instruments that came in after I finished college, we have no bloody clue. So I would like this to be, if we get an educationist on, it's about time we address that. It should be taken more seriously. Sex education, first. Financial education, second. And also social education, how to behave. See, kids behave really badly. A lot of pressing, pushing, touching, coughing, letting out different things in front of other people in society. All this has to end.
Yeah.
Although I remember when I was young in school, it was co-ed school, I could put my elbow on the next desk and touch Natasha's elbow. And as a 12-year-old, that was like, you know, I mean, I can't, what a feeling that was, literally. I should just wait and, you know, and so we have to do it slowly, you know, like a real creep, first half inch, then half inch. And I'm annexing territory like that. And then if she didn't move her elbow, it was, for me, it was like, you know, love is in the air and all those jingles are playing in the background. Oh, damn. What a creep, really. Ouch. Oh, but if I try it now, she'll slap me. I wonder if she remembers. We never discussed it. It never went anywhere. But I would. She was sitting next to me. Very pretty girl. Also very intelligent. Ah, good time. Oh, well. Move on. Yep. Next.
Architect Vineet says, I want to watch the show with my wife, but topless Cyrus gives me insecurity. That you just need to work out, man. Architect Vineet.
Oh, she's back. She's back.
Hey.
Architect,
yeah.
But... you have better erections than anybody.
Hello?
I mean, you're
hey, hi,
yeah, hello, Aditi.
Hi,
sir.
Hi, Aditi. Welcome back. Again? Welcome back. Gone again? Oops. This is like any relationship I've ever had. Gone, comes back, goes. No consistency. Stay. Give us a chance. One chance, man. One chance.
So she's trying to reconnect properly. It's fine. Now she's back.
Okay, while she's reconnecting, I'll just answer the architect. I'm just saying that my stuff is always practical. This is my gift to the world. Dress for the occasion. And the occasion is I sweat too much doing this damn podcast. So unless the other person is taking offense, only seeing the chin, nothing really I mean, I'm not really, you know, it's not really a vulgar display. I'm seeing shoulders, I guess, a little bit, but I can't avoid that. I'll try to. So that's it. It's not that I want to. It's just too hot, this country. I would have left for the British, but I wasn't born in 47. I would have been on those boats. Mountbatten, wait for me. Wait for me. I've gone straight to the coldest North England, you know, Lancashire, Yorkshire, one of those places, and settled down there, Bradford, and become one of those terrible brown skin kids.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Yes, we can hear you. Yeah.
People on the live chat are saying what happened to Aditi. They're calling the police, fire ambulance. we've lost her.
Disaster management committee or whatever. Yeah. No, she's I mean, here. I think she's having problem connecting to her mic and video.
But at least her picture is there. So, in a sense, we have her.
yeah, she's here, guys. We're not lying to you. Okay.
Yeah. Because, I mean, that for me, that's as long as she doesn't talk, she's still with us and we'll carry on. Oh, she's back. She's back. She's actually back. Everybody. And if she stays for 5 seconds, that means she'll stay.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. No worries.
I'm now because my headphones died and my phone died simultaneously. So, now I'm talking through my Bluetooth speaker.
Okay, you sound like a pilot in an old Air India plane, you know, and you also sound disinterested just like the pilot. So that's good because you're at the right place for that. We moved on to the AMAs. Sorry, you were in the middle of a story and all that, but we had to move on to the AMAs to pretend like, you know, nothing happened and it's a professional show. So we, you know, without blinking, me and Silvi just carry on. Ki, woh toh hai, side mein. Woh aayi wapas. Don't worry. And our audience is damn nice. They say this show is so bad in terms of standard that we don't expect it to be more professional. You know, they keep writing in, bacha, ye bahut acha hai. For by your level, this is great. So Aditi, don't worry. I mean, the host doesn't have clothes. How low can the show go? And it's not a sex show from any angle. It's just cheap. You know, no sponsor, no future. This is it. This is comedy. So let's get the AMAs for Aditi.
Okay, before we go into the AMAs, Aditi, I have a question. How long were you in boarding school in Panswini? And how bad was the mess?
Yeah.
You know, that's actually where I got my emotional eating issues from. because I was actually in boarding school for the Panchkani part of it for 2 years, 9th and 10th.
Same, 9th and 10th. What are you saying?
What trauma.
Wow.
Second to 8th, I was in Pune boarding school. And you know what? That's a universal law of boarding school, that if you come out of boarding school, you end up a haurat in like post boarding school, because you, I feel like I would eat every meal like it's my last.
Yeah.
Because you never knew kab Maggi milega phir se.
Exactly.
Kab chowri
dal. No, I don't understand. So you're saying it was good or it was bad?
You know, depending on how you see it. But frankly, it was awful. I loved it. The reason I loved
it. You get used to it. Classical conditioning. Yeah. It's like how you like jail after some time. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Exactly.
Is that why we like our mother's cooking? God, you've killed it. We all like our mother's cooking because we're forced to eat it every day. And then after some time, classical cuisine, go, yeah, and you just like it. If we had a choice, mom, if we had a choice. Damn it, they fooled us for so many years, Silvi.
That's why I'm adopted by Chawla's restaurant.
My boarding school used to give us non-veg food thrice a week. So Wednesday, Friday and Sunday used to be non-veg, okay? But the last 6 months that I was there, the last 6 months of my 10th standard, they made all non-veg days into anda days. So you should get eggs instead of chicken and mutton biryani. We're getting anda biryani, dude. This is just a Maharashtrian school.
Dude, they must have reduced the fees also. Because anyway, aisa matlab mere ko liver biryani khane ka jyada shauk nahi hai. Chicken ke brain ka taste bahut disgusting hai. So I would rather eat anda biryani than eat some of the things that were passing.
I think y'all are missing the point. Y'all are discussing the food. Okay, the food per se is not important. It's the quality of the food. Because that's always subjective. I like biryani and I like basmati or whatever. The end of the day, what is the quality of the food? Because the problem in all these cheap canteens is that oily...
No. It'll be clean. And because it was a boarding school, it was slightly healthier. And they had like a nutritionist who used to come and at least design the...
Okay. Wait, the fancy
school. Your school, they had nutritionist and all. Apne school, there was
comedians.
None of that.
No? Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
The principal was the cook.
We had to bring our own fire to cook over there.
Wow. Yeah. Hey, we should do a whole thing with boarding school stories. Yeah. You all have a subculture of your own.
That'd be great. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
It's another world altogether.
I tried to run away once and then I took Lysol as my weapon in case somebody attacks me. I had a bottle of Lysol this big. Then I got out to Panchgani bus station with a bottle of Lysol. Then I realized that I just didn't want to run away.
How do you exit the school?
I went because it was a convent, so it was attached to a church and there was a grotto in between the school and the church, so I spent the night in the grotto and then
in the grotto
and then I left from there at about 11 o'clock. I thought 11 o'clock was like super late, dude.
So you use religion to get out?
Yes. Yes. Which is how a lot of people Which is how I've been running this country, okay? So don't judge me for using it to get out.
No judgment. This is what education gave you. But so you actually spent a whole night. That's a lot of... You really hated it.
Yeah. I really hated it. But I was roaming at Panchgani bus station and I realized I hated Panchgani bus station more. So then I went back quietly and I never got caught.
But then they know now.
Oh my God, Sister Sadhna is watching this. I don't know who you are.
But what's the name?
Sister Sadhna,
if anybody knows her, please tell her. Aditi ran away, came back in the early hours of the morning, but she was in church for many of those hours. So in a sense, she paid her bills. Siri, did you try to run away?
I sneaked out of school once and I got back to school and I got caught. So I never ran again.
No, but you sneak out to run away like she did, or you were trying to meet a girl or the,
No, just to eat. I went out to eat good food in the market, in Panchgani market, and then
came back. The difference between the Punjabis and the UPIites, Ms. Mittal. Who wanted to escape torture? He just wanted to eat better food.
That's so exactly. I had a good butter chicken.
I would have said, "Aapka reason bahut badhiya hai. You must go. You must go." Okay. Guy just wanted a good meal. You know, I mean, they give him anda every day for 70 days.
Yes.
That's a bit too much, actually. That's worse than prison. Even prison gives you variety, man. It's ridiculous. Man. Okay, come on, guys. 10:57 next AM.
All right. No, Harvest Kasad asked for Aditi. Hello, all. Aditi, who did you look up to when you started in stand-up comedy, and who is your favorite comedian?
So, you know, there was nobody to look up to, which is actually, I love this question because it makes me reflect all the time. And I think it was a little, it's a little sad to say now. No, it's not sad, but it's a distinct to say now that it was the usual suspects. It was George Carlin. It was, you know, Russell Peters. These were the most commonly seen faces. And so we just sort of like those are the people you looked up to. And though I do remember enjoying Margaret Cho very much. And she's one of those that I
remember Margaret Cho.
Oh, she's such a badass. And so I remember, like, I think those were the sort of people. Now, of course, I'll be more nuanced. I'd be like Ali Wong and, you know, friggin' Beth Stelling and all these people. But say.
I've got an idea for both of you. Your next specials, either of you or both, should be boarding school. It's not a topic that's been really done in comedy enough. You know, I think it could be really funny. I mean, just the stories you just told, like the canteen, the food, the escapes. I mean, they're just a really interesting, your perspective.
You know, it's like a little bit of like Lord of the Flies, na?
Yeah.
Where bachchan who are suddenly in charge. It's a fucking jungle out there. Dude, I have had the most vicious fights in boarding school over friendship. So they used to call me Neville Longbottom, okay? Because that's who I reminded everyone of in from the Harry Potter series or whatever. And I remember somebody once said Neville Lumbigan to me, okay? And I remember, and it was really quite funny.
It's a direct translation. It's not really an insult. I mean, if you're going to talk about it on a Google Translate, I mean, if I was the guy in charge, how much better would I? What would you do? Silvia, I'm giving you a Hindi fight. How would you come up with it?
But I remember being so offended, and that was my first and only physical fight. I got kicked in the groin, and as it turns out, it also hurts for girls. It also hurts. I mean, I don't know what it would be for guys, but
I've never seen a girl's groin. I would not even know where to start. They don't even show me their face most of the time. It's usually like that. Like Manoj Kumar in the early movies, you know, just cover there. The hand comes up. Oh. Oof. But you had not completed your story about your dad and you coming to see a show, one of our stand-up shows, I presume, or a play or something.
Yeah, it was a stand-up show. You had done like multiple characters, and then we are sitting in the audience. You come into the audience and you start talking to us, right? And then you turn to my dad, and I'm sitting next to my dad, and I was dressed like, I also was obsessed with dressing up, I think, during that period of my life. So I was dressed like I was going to a wedding, okay? And my dad was in like boxer shorts or something. Like, he had come in boxer shorts and t-shirts, okay? So
he was selling pants all day.
Correct. So he was like, no need for pants. He comes in boxer shorts, t-shirts. I am in salwar kameez, full makeup, fucking just elaborate cheap jewelry. And you come and you're like, so, who paid for you to be here today? So I pointed to my dad. And you're like, and you were like, I didn't know these are also available right now. And my dad laughed so hard. And I'm like, he just called your daughter a prostitute. And my dad's like, this is the funniest thing that has ever happened to me. I was like, great. So he loved you. He loved you.
He's and
like,
I've never been mean to you. I can be naughty and cheeky, but I'll never be rude, mean. So just a distinction. God, I'm a saint. Oh.
No, but also,
I mean, the halo.
You have a vibe, dude. I'm telling you, Cyrus, you have a vibe. Like, I was watching a review of LOL, okay? And I got, like, some pretty vicious shit was said about me. Universally across the board, people are like, Cyrus Brocha, man, that guy, he really knows his stuff. And I was like, what do you know? He was also fucking playing at the same level as us.
Me and Akash have the same plan. Just stay in the background as long as possible until you have to, so you don't crack. But then this abusing and this, God, and Silvery, just try it, man. Two women, I know them, but I don't know, they're not that close to me that, you know, I'm, you know, and they talk about my penis for 1 hour. I mean, how unfortunate for my wife. Say, Malika, she was so suffering for her wife. And the reply was, 25 saal kam se kam. So they're abusing my age. And they did really good, funny stand-up. When you want to insult someone and you have kunnas, you don't need to prepare, right? Boom, boom, boom. It was like, punch, counter punch, punch, counter punch. And I'm caught in the middle. And then Suresh comes in the middle with this stupid expression.
You know how that happened? Is I had prepared some things. I was like, I'm going to tell him that, look, on your podcast, only it's called Cyrus Says because only Cyrus talks in it, etc., etc. And then Malika walks in whatever child character and she starts talking about you and Nunnu, okay? And for me, I was like, I'm not going to say no to her suggestion of Nunnu, right? So I was like, yes, let's build on this mythology.
Nunnu, you kept a Maharashtrian bhai sort of accent. She had a Punjabi housewife accent. And that idiot is trying to do Bengali, lost interest and became a Malayali and then a Bawa. And all this is, myriad shit is happening at one go. So, you know, if it's funny in so many different ways, it's not fair. And then they attack my manhood and my sexuality. It was like a nuclear warfare. And I can't say anything back. And I can't even smile. So I can't join them. I can't attack them. I'm just stuck there like a loser. Trying to be, I think the game is called statue. You look at your career and you think this is what it's come down to. They abused you and you stand still. Oof, horrible.
Yeah. 25 years in comedy. There and you now, go,
yeah.
Why don't you?
Yeah, really? Yeah, not that my wife is proud of me in any way, shape or form, now that you bring it up. Chalo, we're nearly done, quickly. Oh, we've gone over time.
One last comes in from Karan Sethi. Yeah. He asks, Aditi, what was a funny incident you have about getting heckled on stage?
Honestly, I love people who like to talk. It's really irritating when they talk and it breaks your train of thought. That's really irritating. I think the last really good heckle, I think I was talking about, this was way back, 2015 May. I was talking about sanitary napkins and some guy's like, we don't need to know. And I said, from the rate we're going, you will never know. And audience was like, yes, yes.
By then you're established. I wonder what would it have been like when you were new, like the Kunal moment. Because then when they, in a bar, they can be really rude. Whatever, I've seen sometimes some jokers drunk enough and, you know, how do you handle that?
I realized the beginning was so fucking scary. I was hosting a show, 11 o'clock show at Canvas Laugh Club. No, that time it was called Comedy Store, okay, 2013 May. And, my heart is still beating when I think about it. I was hosting a show and there was a gang in front and they were all pretty wasted, right? And it's always fun to talk to wasted people. And so I was sort of like thoda interacting with them. And then I made the rookie mistake of being like, sir, there was one gentleman who was talking continuously. I said, sir, if you're that interested in talking, you know, why don't you come up on stage? And you're not supposed to fucking say that, okay? Nobody fucking tells you this. You're not supposed to. He comes on stage, he takes the mic from me, and then he stands on my toes, like face to face, as if we were fucking like, you know how you do cutesy shit with your fucking, like, partner. He stood on my toes and he was holding me and like talking into the mic and I was holding the mic up to him like that. And it ended very badly for me. The club afterwards was like, you know what, Aditi, we're going to take you off hosting for a while because you're an idiot. And I was like,
but was he abusive? Was he abusive?
No. I mean, he was talking. Just drunk talk, I think.
Obnoxious drunk, yeah, okay.
Haan,
you can't argue because it makes no sense. Yeah, I can imagine.
Correct.
Now you know what my wife goes through.
And there was like his friends or whatever right in front. Like the whole front row was them. And they were all in various levels of inebriation. And I was like,
That's a great act actually to have, you know, because they're going to back their own guy and they're just going to, you know, be like hyenas and no matter what you do or how smart you are, they're not going to ready to respond. So you either join them or you have to find some distraction. There's not much to do because the vocalization of the drunk man is not easy to overcome because he's just loud.
Oh no, it's not.
Celebrity, always keep a drunk man as a plant in your show if it's not going well. You can blame him for everything.
Hey, come up on stage, man.
I don't understand what you're saying. And that's it. The show was cancelled. It was really going well.
Hey, man, do you like standing on toes? Come on stage, yes.
Recent one I got was, I was doing a set on this very, channel. On this very Zoom. Why does Zoom feel like its own fucking physical place? I was doing a show on Zoom and somebody wrote in the comments, this is, and I was doing like political comedy. Someone wrote, this is worse than the news that we hear these days. So then I addressed it. I was like, yeah, you're right. You know, news is pretty bad. I guess, you know, you're coming here to get your fix or something.
And then after that, he followed me on email. And I still get emails from him saying, what is your problem? What more do you think the government can do? I was like, it's not my job.
Yeah.
Not my job to tell the government what to do, what's wrong.
He didn't point out ticket, show, 2 hours, relationship over. You didn't point that out.
Yeah, people take it so personally. Arre, kaise bol diya ye? Yeah, I don't know why.
But the thing is, when you're a comedian, you guys know better than me, they think of you as a normal person. So they want to be your friend, although when they like you, you know, it's not like a film star where they get intimidated to come to you. So this is the problem. The more successful you are, the more the common man is like, I can go hang with you because I like you.
You know, this is actually one of the deceptions of stand-up also is that you want to nurture that familiarity, but it actually doesn't exist.
Of course it doesn't.
Like, you don't know each other.
You can't come into your private zone. What are you talking about? This stalker. It's one thing in the show, he can do what he wants, or just outside or before and after. That's fine. But post that, at 3 in the afternoon, you're, you know, hanging out with your friends at home, and the guy comes in and says, what do you think of Modi government? Come on, man. Okay, listen, guys, it's going on too long. Can we stop?
Yep.
11:08. Because it's her, you're giving her so much bow because you're a comedian and from Panchgani and all that crap. This is bipartisanship.
It's our network.
Okay, Aditi, well done.
Thank you
great
so much
career.
For having me, Cyrus.
I know it's not even halfway through, so we'll keep having you on again. Okay.
Sorry, have a great one. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Okay,
thank you.
Bye, everybody. Okay, catch us on any of the podcasting apps, please. We beg you, we need you. Send us your questions on Twitter on Cyrus Says In, or you can email us, even if you're not female, on whatcyrussays@gmail.com.
Namaskar, dear friends. My name is Ashish Vidyarthi. Life, as you know, is a journey. And you and I, travelers, how can we celebrate this travel? I have a podcast for you, Begin the Journey. I share stories and moments from my life. Do tune in every Monday and Thursday to listen to my podcast on the IVM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcast from. Cheers.
We live in an age of disruption, of immense change in every aspect of work, life, and business. But is the old way of doing things truly dead? And are we ever going to stop saying the new normal? Join me, Varun Dugirala, on Advertising is Dead every Tuesday as I talk to entrepreneurs, leaders, creators, and change makers from across business, media, marketing, and beyond to dig a little deeper into how we got here, what we're doing now, and where we're headed. You can catch all the episodes of Advertising is Dead on the IBM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcasts from.